Welcome to the Rock Church and World Outreach Center. We pray that this message will strengthen and encourage you. Now, here's a message from Pastor Deborah Cobray.
Are you ready tonight? We have been looking at the end times and doing a series on that, and we've had a shared teaching team of Pastor Dan, Pastor Luke, myself, and then Dr. Kobernick will be joining us next week. And he teaches eschatology in the Bible College. And so we have a collage of teachers, and we are at the Rock, a church that for many years, I mean, Jim and I have been around for a long time, long enough to have been able to see winds of doctrine and winds of teaching blowing back and forth over the decades. And I'm a boomer. I was born in 1950, so you know how old I am. And I can remember my mom and dad. My mom was a Christian, and I can remember my mother telling me, as an evangelical Christian, my dad wasn't saved, but my mom was a phenomenal believer, and she came from a long line of missionaries. And she married a real heathen, my father, but he got saved before he went home to be with the Lord this year. But the point is that she told me that in World War II, they firmly believed that Hitler was the Antichrist. And rightfully so. If I was alive during those days, I probably would have been right there with him. And then being born in 1950, I grew up as a boomer, and there was what we called the Jesus movement in the late 60s, early 70s. And I got saved and swept into the kingdom of God in that movement. And of course, we can't but know if we're Californians, Calvary Chapel, and they were baptizing hippies. I was a hippie. My ex-husband was in Vietnam, and we were in Germany, and we did drugs and brought drugs back from Europe into the United States. That's what a fool I was. But there was a great move of God, and there was a move of God, and there was pictures in Time magazine of just people lined up in the Pacific Ocean, and there they were just baptizing people one after another, and it was a time of great shaking, and we moved landmarks, my generation. I mean, we took prayer out of school, abortion came in, free love and sex, many, many landmarks, things that are boundaries and perimeters to keep us healthy in a moral society. They were moved. And along with that great movement of rebellion was also a great movement of grace. And there was great salvation, and there was great things happening in the kingdom of God, and the baptism of the Holy Spirit, the charismatic movement, and just getting filled with the Holy Spirit. And that's where I met Jim, and I was in a ministry house in Santa Barbara, and Jim was a businessman, and he had a radio station in Santa Barbara, and he'd been married 3 times, and everybody dumped him, and I'd been married to a drug dealer, and so here I was coming back to God, and here he was on the radio, and our pastor introduced us, and voila, here we are today. But I say all that to say that I have been through many moves of God, the Word of Faith movement, the Great Faith movement, and then the Watched Hillsong, invented Hillsong, preached at Color with Bobby Houston. And I've been able and been privileged by God to have lived long enough to see many theories. And when I decided 15 years ago that I wanted to teach the end times in the book of Revelation, and my husband said, sure, go ahead. The Rock was, you know, probably about 10 years old. I had no idea what I was getting into. When I decided to teach the book of Revelation, and I thought one of my favorite Bible teachers is Jack Hayford, Pastor Jack Hayford. He was a pastor to us, Church on the Way, the Foursquare Church, And I thought, well, you know, I was raised up in an evangelical community, raised up in Calvary Chapel, raised up in all of these wonderful moves of God. And I'd only been taught one thing, the 7-year tribulation. How many have heard of the 7-year tribulation? I didn't know that there wasn't other things, but I just knew the 7-year tribulation, and I knew that, you know, Russia and China were going to join together, and everybody was going to come against Israel, and the Antichrist, and the 144,000, and I knew, you know, I read all the books by, you know, the great late Planet Earth. Anybody read that book? And, you know, it saved a lot of people, scared the hell right out of us. So when I decided to study the end times, as a pastor and a pastor's wife, I had no idea what I was getting into when I heard from a teacher I respected, that there was a whole other way of looking at Revelation. A whole other way. And I just went, oh no, this is messing me all up. There was a nice timeline. I had it all figured out. 7 years, Daniel, the 9th chapter, 70 weeks, because you won't find 7 years in the book of Revelation. You'll only get that when you study Daniel and you look at chapter 9. But as I began to read and study and do the research, I began to see that there were holes in the dispensational theory of the end times. I didn't even know what dispensationalism was. And then I studied it and I began to see that in the 1850s, that there was a pastor who had a member of his congregation, a woman who had dreams, and she shared these dreams and this dispensationalism, and he looked at it and he studied it and he agreed with it. And then Scofield took it in the turn of the 20th century, put it in his Bible. And from that time on, there was nothing else taught. Now, I don't know if you've ever studied it, but you have. If you have, you found that there are some big holes in dispensationalism. And so here we are now at the Rock. And I started teaching the book of Revelation, like I said, 15 years ago. And I just went, oh, Jesus, help me. Jack Hayford is messing me all up. That was 15 years ago. And I'm here to tell you today that I don't know if it's 7 years of tribulation, the timeline like dispensationalism teaches, if it's historical, if it's other things. There's many theories on Revelation. This is what I know, and this is what we do at The Rock. We teach what we know, and we don't argue over end time theology, and we don't speculate over what could be, because in the book of Revelation, when you open it, and if you'll go there with me, are you all right with me? You're all going, oh, I know. Heresy, heresy. No, 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 it's not heresy. Let's be wise as serpents and harmless as doves. I'm not here to mess you up. If you believe the 7-year tribulation theory, I hope they're right. I hope they're right. I'm not here to argue whether they are or they're not. I can only preach what I know out of the mouth of 2 or 3 witnesses. Let every word be established. And you know, when it comes to these things, it's as if God took a giant curtain and he has just pulled back the curtain and allowed us as his people to peek into eternity. But I know this, the generation that will be alive, that last generation, whether it's our generation or our grandchildren or my grandchildren's children, however long the Lord tarries, that generation will read the book of Revelation and it will make perfect sense to them and they will know it. For now, the curtain is held back. We have a peek and a glimpse into these things, and to speculate and to argue is foolish. But this is what it says in the book of Revelation chapter 1. And let me read it to you. The revelation of Jesus Christ, which God gave him to show his servants, things which must shortly take place. And he sent and he signified it by his angel to his servant John. In other words, it's the revelation of Jesus. It's Jesus, not just the revelation of what is going on in the book that he's sharing with John, but in the book itself is the picture and the revelation and the summation of Jesus Christ. And my son Luke preached this morning a phenomenal message on testing. And if you want to get one CD this week that is amazing, they're all great. Pastor Dan is a phenomenal teacher. My husband, we're blessed with the teaching team here at The Rock. But he taught on heart tests. And he taught about the heart test. And he said, this thing is all about Jesus. And there was not a more truer statement that my son could have said. Because from Genesis to Revelation, this is his story, history. There's a scarlet cord that runs all the way through, and it's all about Jesus. And when you and I sit here and draw swords over end time theology, we are missing the very revelation of the book. And that is to paint a picture of the kingdom of God, of our King himself. If you want to know what the throne of God looks like and you want to get close to Jesus and into his presence, all you have to do is just begin to say, Holy Spirit, as I read chapters 4 and 5, make it real to me. Make it come alive to me. And the Spirit of God, who is the revelator of the church and the teacher of the church. And Jesus said, the Holy Spirit, when he comes, he will take of that which belongs to me and he will give it to you. He will take you on a journey into heaven, and you'll be at the throne of God, and you will see the magnificent beings. You will see all of these things, and he'll begin to unravel and teach you the important things for your life out of the book of Revelation. And so I say all that to say that tonight, my assignment is to bring you the chapters of 19, 20, 21 and 22. Now, I don't know how far we're going to get because I know Dr. Kobernick is a phenomenal teacher and he's going to bring a message on the bridegroom and I'm going to have him do what I don't do, which is very easy for him because he's brilliant. But tonight, I want to look at the coming of the Lord and at chapters 19, 20 and 21. When I was with you 3 weeks ago or 2 weeks ago, whenever it was, and I began to unfold to you a new concept of revelation, kind of weaning us away from dispensationalism just a little bit. Like I said, if that's where you are, go for it. We are not saying that that might not pan out. We're not saying that. We're just saying that to put all of our stock in that and miss revelations that God wants us to have is foolish. And so when I began to share with you about another way of looking at Revelation, we looked at chapters 4 and 5, which is the throne of God, and there John goes up into the heaven. The Spirit says, come up, and I want to show you what is to come. He's in the throne room of God, and he sees God, and he sees this scroll. And no one can open this scroll. And no one is worthy in heaven or on earth. No one is worthy to open that scroll. And John begins to weep, and he weeps, and he weeps, and he cries. And an elder, one of the 24 elders, says, do not weep, for the Lion of the tribe of Judah has overcome. And he is worthy to take the scroll. And John opens his eyes, and he looks, and there, standing before the throne of God, is a lamb slain from the foundation of the earth. In other words, what that means in the original text is he sees a lamb with the fresh marks of slaughter on him. He can still see the blood. And he's standing before the throne of God. And the lamb takes the scroll. And the scroll has writing on the front. It has writing on the back. And the scroll has 7 seals on it. And he begins to unloose those seals. And here is a key in Revelation. There are 7 seals. The 7th seal unlocks and opens the 7 trumpets. There are 7 trumpets. The 7th trumpet, the last trumpet, unleashes and unlocks the 7 bowls of God's wrath. And when those 7 bowls of God's wrath are released on the earth, there is very little of humanity left standing. There is very little of the earth left. Catastrophic things have happened. And in every single incident of a 7, the 7th seal, the 7th trumpet, there is a cataclysmic earthquake and a shaking. That 6th seal is the earthquake. And then the 7th seal opens the 7 trumpets. And the 7th trumpet releases the 7 bowls of God's wrath. And out of the temple comes this horrific, shaking, crushing earthquake. Could it be that instead of linear, and if you've got a piece of paper, I'm going to have you just draw a line on a piece of paper, a small line. That's us in time. We live in a linear, 3-dimensional world. Could it be that God himself, who created time, who's not bound by time, time is bound by God. Could it be that he who lives in eternity, that he is not bound by this linear movement? And could it be that prophecy, which has fulfillment in many different places and in many different occasions. The day of the Lord has 4 specific fulfillments. There's the great and coming day of the Lord in Hosea, in Joel, in Micah, We know that there were judgments in Israel. That was the first day of the Lord. Then the second day of the Lord was when he came as a babe. That's a day of the Lord. Then the third day of the Lord is his third coming or his second coming. The day of the Lord, it says so. And then the fourth coming is the great and the terrible day of God's wrath when he visits the earth. So you see, prophecy has different fulfillments. Could it be that maybe, just maybe, the seals and the trumpets and the bowls of wrath are overarching, interacting, and they're stacked on top of each other? Because we live in time, but God lives in eternity. That is why he was slain from the foundation of the world. It had already happened. That is why when I was in sin and selling dope and bringing hash back from Germany, how stupid. And you would have looked at me and said, she'll never amount to anything, and she'll never be a Christian, and she'll never serve God. God already had my life written, the end from the beginning, and I was already seated with him in heavenly places. When we step out of time and we stop looking at the Word of God in a linear, three-dimensional fashion, suddenly God makes a little more sense. Suddenly we begin to see maybe we don't get this quite like we think we do. And all I'm asking you to do as a believer is to give the Holy Spirit the opportunity to talk to you about what is and what isn't. And it's fun to read these books. It's great to wonder, gee, here's Russia, Iran, and Syria. There's a threefold alliance. They're all coming against Israel and the blood moons. And before you know it, we're getting out of here. Listen, I was in Israel in July. I do not doubt that God is doing something very supernatural on this earth. And I'm saying it might be right. But if it isn't, and if the Lord tarries, he still has a command in the Word of God that we are to watch and we are to prepare and we are to be ready at any moment to go with him. Whether there's a temple built on the mound and where the Dome of the Rock is, or whether there isn't, whether nations are aligning according to the latest speculation means nothing. What means everything is that you and I do what Jesus said. And he said, until this gospel is preached to every nation, you can't come home. There's a homework assignment, church. You can't sit there and want me to beam you up out of any persecution or hardship. I need you to get into the highways and the byways of this planet and preach the gospel to every nation, and then the end will come. Church, let's get busy doing what God's told us to do and not speculating. Having said all that, taken all this time, I want to go to these chapters and look at what's happening. So I'm titling this the beginning or the end of the beginning. So what do I want to cover tonight? I want to look at the millennium. What is it? I want to look at the great white throne judgment. Luke touched on it, but I want to look at it tonight. He taught beautifully last week on the judgment seat of Jesus Christ. As believers, you and I are not going to be judged whether or not we're getting into heaven. That is a done deal. Done. Finished. You are justified. You've been glorified. You are holy before the Lord God Almighty. Your sins are as far as the east is from the west. Covered in the blood of Jesus. He who knew no sin was made to be sin so you and I could be the righteousness of God in Christ Jesus. We will be judged on how we lived our lives and what we did during the time we were here. Because eternity is long and our lifespan is very, very short. So Luke taught on the judgment seat of Christ. And so we see in chapter 19 that the Lord returns. The second coming of Jesus Christ in Revelation chapter 19. Then if you travel now, like I said, Revelation chapter 18, Revelation chapter 17, Revelation chapter 16, these chapters begin to deal with the bowls of wrath and in the days of the blowing of the last trumpet. So this doesn't happen just overnight. There's days of the blowing of the seventh trumpet. We taught on the rapture. Harpazo is the word for rapture. When is it? Well, is it pre? Is it mid? Is it post? At this church, we say it's ready rapture. Let's hope for the best, but prepare for the worst. What's wrong with that? Let's be ready when the Lord comes. And so we looked at rapture, harpazo, that there is indeed a rapture. That is something we can preach at this church because it's there in the Word of God very clearly. As to when it is, we don't know. We just preach as shepherds of this house to get you ready so that it doesn't matter when that last trumpet blows, you and I are ready. We preach that there is not going to be wrath that you and I are appointed to because we're not appointed to the wrath of God. So we don't have to worry about that. Will there be persecution? Yes. Do we need to be afraid? Oh, absolutely not. Because the grace of God is more than enough for any kind of trouble we're going to face as believers in Him. But in the 16th chapter and in the 17th chapter, we see that there is a whore, a great whore, and her name is Babylon. And it's interesting that Satan has his harlot and Jesus has his bride. It's interesting that this harlot, Babylon the Great, sits on seven hills, and she sits, and she's drunk with the blood of the saints and the martyrs. Now, she's destroyed, and her burning is great, and the kings of the earth and the merchants of the earth mourn, and what I believe this is a picture of this world system that is absolutely destined to fall and to be absolutely destroyed. And everything that we know, everything that we've loved, everything that we've entered into, from media to political to economic, all that is this world is under the lordship of a very fallen system. And it is doomed to destruction. And we see this in Babylon the Great when she's destroyed, the harlot. And we see the Lord in chapter 19. And there He is coming, and we are with Him. He has a host, an army with Him. That's you and I. And we're riding with Him, and there is a great battle, and at the blast of His breath, it's destroyed. The beast is captured, the false prophet who works signs in His presence by which he deceived those who received the mark of the beast and those who worshiped His image, verse 20 of chapter 19. They are cast into the lake of fire. So we see that there is a dragon, Satan, there's a beast, the Antichrist, and there's his false prophet. So Satan has his unholy trinity. We see that Satan has his harlot. We see that there are opposites because there's two kingdoms that are in conflict here. The kingdom of darkness and the kingdom of God. And it has been so before the foundations of the world. Sin did not start on planet Earth. It started in the temple of God when Lucifer, who was a cherub, went into that temple and said, I will be like the Most High God. I will ascend into the sides of the north. I will be like God apart from God. And sin began in heaven. And that is why there's going to be a new heaven and a new earth. And there's not going to be a temple, because a temple will be no more, because God will be all and in all and reside with people. You and I were created by God in His image for very specific reasons. There is a timeline of God. Even Jesus didn't know what it was. There is a program going forth. God is reconciling all things in heaven and in earth to Himself through the cross. And you and I are a part of this magnificent reconciliation and restoration program. It's amazing. Ephesians chapter 1, I read it when I first started with you, verses 9 and 10, 3 weeks ago. The kingdom of God. So here we see now that the demonic is destroyed. We see that the bowls of wrath have come. We see that Babylon and the world system is absolutely, absolutely, completely annihilated. There's not a lot of people left on the earth. And here we see now in chapter 20, and let's go there to see the millennium. Are you with me? Then I saw an angel coming down from heaven, having the key to the bottomless pit and a great chain in his hand. He laid hold of the dragon, that serpent of old, who is the devil and Satan, and bound him for 1,000 years. So we see that the scriptures are very clear here. There's no room for interpretation. It is the devil, the serpent, Satan. And he's bound for 1,000 years. And he cast him into the bottomless pit and shut him up and set a seal on him so that he should deceive the nations no more until the 1,000 years were finished. But after these things, he must be released for a little while. So let's go now to chapter 20. And he's speaking now of what we call the millennium. Now, what is the millennium? Well, the word millennium means 1,000. So the millennium is a 1,000-year transition period where Jesus Christ is going to reign in righteousness and shows the earth what it would have been like if sin had never entered the world. The king has come to his kingdom. We're in chapter 20, not chapter 19, where he comes with us. We are now here. Who is in the millennium? Well, let's look and see. Let's look at verse 4. You with me? And I saw thrones, and they sat on them, and judgment was committed to them. Then I saw the souls of those who had been beheaded for their witness to Jesus and for the word of God, who had not worshipped the beast or his image and had not received his mark on their foreheads or on their hands, and they lived and reigned with Christ for 1,000 years. So who's in the millennium? Well, it says that he saw thrones. So we see there the believers. Paul said, do you not know that you are going to judge angels? So we know that as kings and priests, we have come back with the Lord and that we are in the millennial reign of God. The resurrected saints and the saints who have been beheaded during the tribulation, who have been martyred, are now in with Jesus Christ, ruling and reigning with him. So let's read the verse. Let me give it to you. Revelation 4, 24. And I saw thrones and they sat on them. Who are they? Who do you think that they are? Who came back with Jesus in chapter 19? The believers, you and I. We're not appointed to the wrath of God. It's over. You and I are with him. And I saw souls of those who were beheaded. So we know there's a great multitude of martyrs in the tribulation, the great tribulation. So we see that the saints before the great tribulation and the martyrs during the great tribulation are now residing with the king and ruling and reigning with Jesus Christ, Jerusalem being the capital. Let's look at it again. And I saw thrones and they sat on them and judgment was committed to them. That's the saints. And I saw the souls of those who had been beheaded. That's the ones who'd not worshiped the beast. And they lived and reigned with Christ for 1,000 years. But the rest of the dead did not live again until the 1,000 years were finished. This is the first resurrection. Blessed and holy is he who has part in the first resurrection. Over such, the second death has no power, but they shall be priests of God and of Christ and shall reign with him 1,000 years. So who's in the millennial? The ones on the thrones, the saints of God, those that were martyred during the tribulation. They are with Jesus during this millennial 1,000-year period of time when Jesus comes to earth, and now he is setting up the kingdom, and the tempter is bound. He is not on the planet. Now listen, you and I, in our imaginations, cannot imagine what earth would be like without a tempter, without a devil. Now, man is still in a fallen state. Those that are left, those that lived through the great tribulation are still in their corporeal bodies. We, on the other hand, are with Jesus Christ. We have died and we have been resurrected and we are with him. Are you with me? We have a body like he has a body. He walked through walls. Do you remember that? He said, give me something to eat. And they're freaking out as he walks through the wall in the upper room and they're all hiding. Do you remember that little scenario in John, the 21st chapter? He says, give me something to eat. Flesh and bone. Feel me. Give me something to eat. I'm not a spirit. I have a new body. And as he is, we shall be like him. When mortality puts on immortality, the Bible tells us very clearly that we are going to have a body like he has a body. So, guys, this is wild. This is more wild than any sci-fi you can see. Because here we are on a destroyed planet, And here is Jesus Christ with the saints, ruling and reigning with him for 1,000 years, and we are not flesh and blood and bone. We are flesh and bone with new bodies like his. This is exciting. You're looking at me like a cow looks at a new gate. What the heck is she talking about? Look, either it's all true or none of it's true. Either it's all true or none of it's true. There is a resurrection. There is a living and a ruling monarch. There is the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. There is the one that died and lives forevermore. There is the one that John saw and said, I have the keys of death and hell. And he fell at his feet as if dead. We are talking about deity beyond anything we can imagine. Now wrap your minds around a world that has no tempter. And Messiah's kingdom is now set up. What does it look like? Glad you asked. You all right with me? The tempter is bound. We saw that, Revelation 21 through 5. There will be no war or destruction. Now God pulls the curtain back and gives us a glimpse. A glimpse. And he gives us a glimpse in the prophets. Isaiah 2:4 says, he shall judge between the nations and rebuke many people. They shall beat their swords into plowshares and their spears into pruning hooks. Nation shall not lift up sword against nation, neither shall they learn war anymore. There will be no war or destruction. Creation will be restored to its original intent. Harmony and peace. Let's go to Isaiah again, 11:6-8. The wolf shall dwell with the lamb. The leopard shall lie down with the young goat. The calf and the young lion and the fatling together, and a little child shall lead them. The cow and the bear shall graze. Their young ones shall lie down together. And the lion shall eat straw like an axe. There goes the food chain. The predators are no more. It is Messiah's kingdom. The nursing child shall play by the cobra's hole. And the weaned child shall put his hand in the viper's den. Creation will be restored to its original intent. Harmony and peace. The earth will be filled with the knowledge of the Lord. Isaiah 11:9, they shall not hurt nor destroy in all my holy mountain, for the earth shall be full of the knowledge of the Lord as the waters cover the sea. The millennium. The population will enjoy long life in Messiah's kingdom. Isaiah 65:22, they shall not build and another inhabit. They shall not plant and another eat. For as the days of a tree, so shall be the days of my people, and my elect shall long enjoy the work of their hands. What happens? Here is Messiah's kingdom. We're ruling and reigning. Now listen, if you think that, you know, Jesus is coming down and zap, everything's perfect again, there's a world that's destroyed. There's going to be work to do. That's why he needs his people to rule and to reign with him. Rebuilding the earth and his kingdom. It's not zap, this is, you know, New York is all back and put together like it was. Guys, we're talking about an apocalypse. The millennium. He comes back. We're with him. There are human beings on the earth, and they are recreating, and their lifespan is going to be as 1,000 years. It says in Isaiah that if a child dies at 100 years old, he will be as an infant. So God has restored longevity to humanity in this kingdom. The kingdom, the kingdom, the king and the kingdom. Now what happens? Well, let's see. After 1,000 years, let's go to Revelation 27. Now when the 1,000 years have expired, Satan will be released from his prison and will go out to deceive the nations which are in the four corners of the earth, Gog and Magog, to gather them together to battle, whose number is as the sand of the sea. He will gather humanity back together, and once again, now the tempter is released back on the earth. And just as this population, as Adam and Eve had to have a tree, had to be tested, this population will have to have the ability to make the choice. Am I going to serve God, or am I going to serve myself? And it says here that when he's released, he gathers the nations from the four corners of the earth. So the earth has been restored 1,000 years. And it says that the numbers are as the sand of the sea. Now, I don't know if you've ever thought about this, but if you lived in a world with no tempter, if you lived with Jesus Christ as the ruling king, if you lived in a kingdom of goodness and holiness and righteousness, where there is no predators, where the lion is eating straw and the tiger and the animal kingdom is restored to what it was, and there is no trouble, there's harmony and peace. They beat their weapons into plowshares. The earth now is bringing forth fruit and bringing forth what God had intended it to bring forth after the cataclysmic bowls of wrath. Are you with me? Here comes, after 1,000 years of this perfect rule, here comes Satan one more time, and the number that join him are as the sand of the sea. Innumerable. You know what that tells me? That tells me there are just going to be some people that would never be happy in heaven. They will never be happy in heaven. There is the seed of the serpent from Genesis and the seed of the woman, Messiah's seed. There are two strains of humanity. The heart will go with Satan, self-centered and selfish, and the heart will go with Messiah. Your needs at my expense, the love of God, or Satan's character and nature, my needs at your expense, selfishness. You're either going to be full of myself or I'm going to be full of God. Either God is at the center of my life, ruling me, or Satan has deceived me into thinking that I am at the center of my life, ruling my own destiny. What fools. Now this is, I love this part. I love this part. You want good reading? Read the Bible. And they went up, verse 9, on the breadth of the earth and surrounded the camp of the saints in the beloved city. That's Jerusalem. The fire came down from God out of heaven and devoured them. The devil who deceived them was cast into the lake of fire and brimstone, where the beast and the false prophet, remember the unholy trinity, are, and they will be tormented day and night forever and ever. So this is my favorite part. There's no war, there's no weapons, there's nothing. Just a blast of God's breath devours Satan and the unnumbered army, and they're just gone, boom, gone. Hasta la vista, you know, baby. Didn't we have a governor somewhere in California at some time that said that? I think his name was Terminator or something. You can tell how old I am. He will be destroyed by fire from God, and he will be cast into the lake of fire forever. The devil who deceived them was cast into the lake of fire and brimstone, where the beast and the false prophet are, and they will be tormented day and night forever and ever. Now we come to the end of chapter 20 and the beginning of chapter 21, and we see a great white throne judgment. Then I saw a great white throne, that's what it says, verse 11, and he who sat on it, from whose face the earth and the heaven fled away, and there was found no place for them. That's why I know there is a millennium, because now there's no place for heaven and earth. It's gone. The sky rolls up like a scroll, and earth is vanished. It is finished. It's gone. And I saw the dead, small and great, standing before God, and the books were opened, and another book was opened, which is the book of life. And the dead were judged according to their works by the things which were written in the books. The sea gave up the dead who were in it. Death and Hades delivered up the dead who were in them, and they were judged, each one according to his works. And then death and Hades were cast into the lake of fire. This is the second death. Death and Hades are thrown into the fire. I believe that these could be angelic beings. In every culture, in every legend, there is a keeper of hell and death. You've seen the specters. We just went through Halloween, did we not? The one that carries the sickle, death. And Hades, the place of the dead. In the Greek theology, there is a being that guards the place of the dead. Listen, humanity has eternity in its heart. It has eternity in its heart because God put eternity in us. We're made in his image. We didn't climb out of some ooze, and we didn't evolve into who we are now. We were created in the image of God. There was a fall in the Garden of Eden. We turned over the title deed of this planet and the rule of this planet through sin, rebellion, and deception to Lucifer, who is Satan, the dragon, and the serpent. And he has been ruling over mankind since then. And God had a plan to bring himself, because he knew we couldn't save ourselves. So he knew the only one that could save us would be he himself. So he became a man. He identified with us. He went to that cross. He died on that cross. He shed his blood on that cross. He paid for your sin and my sin. And then he raised himself. He said, no man takes my life. I lay it down and I pick it up. And when he raised from the dead, he had the keys of death and hell. And he overcame death and hell forever and ever. And he is seated at the right hand of the Father. And according to Ephesians, we are his bride, his church, and we are his body. He is the head, and everything is under his feet, and we are here to enforce his victory. Period. It's either all true or none of it's true. So we see this great white throne judgment, and we see that those whose names are not written in the Lamb's Book of Life are judged, and they are hurled into everlasting hell. And I saw the dead, and death and Hades are cast into the lake of fire. Verses 14 and 15. Then death and Hades were cast into the lake of fire. This is the second death. And anyone not found written in the book of life was cast to the lake of fire. This is the second death. So what is hell? Hell, the eternal lake of fire, where inconceivable loneliness, hopelessness, darkness, fierce pain, unconsolable sorrow, unchangeable torment will continue forever and ever. But far worse than this, hell is the place where you will know you could have received him who loved you but chose to reject him. Hell is a place where we will be eternally separated from him who loved us and gave himself for us, and we'll know it. You see, death is not a cessation of being. Death is separation from God. And it has torment and sorrow. So what is hell? Well, Hades, Sheol, is the jail after physical death for the soul and the spirit of human beings waiting for judgment. Luke 16, 20 through 24. I don't have time to talk about these, but read them. Jesus is talking about Lazarus and the rich ruler. This is a real story. He named Lazarus. Lazarus was a beggar, and the rich ruler would throw his scraps out, and Lazarus was sick, and he died, and he's carried to Abraham's bosom. But the rich, rich man is sent into hell, Hades, and there's a great chasm between them. And Lazarus cannot get to him, and he cannot get to Lazarus. It's the holding place, the jail. Tartarus, the jail for the fallen angels. 2 Peter 2:4 says, "For if God did not spare the angels who sinned, but cast them down to hell and deliver them into chains of darkness to be reserved for judgment." Angels are in hell, fallen angels. Jude 1:6 says, "And the angels who did not keep their proper domain, but left their own abode, he has reserved in everlasting chains under darkness for the judgment of the great day, the day of the Lord." Hell is the bottomless pit, the abyss, called destruction in the Old Testament. It's a deep and dismal place of underworld spirits. Proverbs 15:11, "Hell and destruction are before the Lord. How much more the hearts of men?" Hell, Gehenna, the final place of eternal punishment. The Greek word there is Gehenna. Matthew 10:28, "And do not fear those who kill the body but cannot kill the soul, but rather fear him. Fear him who is able to destroy both soul and body in hell." The Greek word for hell, Gehenna, comes from the place outside of Jerusalem. It's called the Valley of Hinnom. The word is used 12 times and is the equivalent to the Hebrew word of Tophet. It is the same meaning in the same place. The Valley of Hinnom was a place of horrible history. Its current history, when Jesus used to speak of it, was the dump outside of the city of Jerusalem used for the dead bodies of criminals where the worms bred and fed on the carcasses. The fires were aided by brimstone, and there was a smoldering constantly in a stench. In the Old Testament, the Valley of Hinnom had been a place of sacrificed victims and children on the altars of Moloch and Baal. All of these details, when Jesus spoke of it, made it become the most frightening and terrible symbol of the reality of Gehenna, the final hell, where the worm does not die and the flame is not quenched. It's a place of indescribable anguish, Matthew 13:42. And I will cast them into the furnace of fire. They will be wailing and gnashing of teeth. A place of unending torment. Mark 9:47. And if your eye causes you to sin, pluck it out. It is better for you to enter the kingdom of God with one eye rather than having two eyes to be cast into hellfire, where the worm does not die and the fire is not quenched. It is a place of utter darkness and hopelessness, separated eternally from the presence of God. 2 Thessalonians 1:9. These shall be punished with everlasting destruction from the presence of the Lord and from the glory of his power. Who will be there? Who's going to hell? Anyone not found written in the book of life will be cast into the lake of fire. Satan, the Antichrist, and the false prophet, the unholy Trinity, the host of fallen angels, principalities, powers, rulers, wicked spirits who have ruled under the control of Satan, the innumerable masses of the wicked dead of mankind, and death and Hades will be cast into the everlasting fire of the pit. So, there's a saying, born once, die twice. Born twice, die once. Born once, die twice. You see, you're born, Jesus said, of the flesh. But there is an experience that he came for so that we could be born of the Spirit, born again. Flesh and blood cannot inherit the kingdom of heaven. My spirit and your spirit, separated through sin, had to be rejoined, had to be purchased, redeemed, then reconciled, brought back to the Father, and then restored to the kingdom. That's what he came to do. Born once, die twice. Born twice, die once. Blessed is he who is in the first resurrection, it said, we read in chapter 20, the saints and the martyrs. Blessed is he who is in the first resurrection. Blessed is he. That's you. That's me. Now, I say all that to say this. Hell is a frightening place. A frightening place. I want to read this quote to you. I've read it before. And I'm going to end, and I'm going to give an altar cloth for those of you that are here tonight. God brought you here for a reason. He brought you here to change your destiny. I'm not going to tell you these things and leave you in fear and trembling. We're going to give you an opportunity to change your destiny tonight. But C.S. Lewis, and I want to read this to you, and I want you to hear me, because church, those of us that are born of the Spirit of God, there's those that are not born of the Spirit of God in this room tonight, and you are listening to my words. And God brought you here sovereignly because he did not make you for hell. He made you for heaven. And you are here tonight and you are going to change destinies tonight. But church, believers, he said, we're not going home until this gospel is preached to the uttermost parts of the earth. We're all ready to get raptured, but God wants us ready to save souls and to see the kingdom come and to see the gospel preached in every direction, in every nation. And I want to read this to you because if I can leave you with this thought tonight, then I've done something here. C.S. Lewis says, this present life is not where our goals, hopes, and dreams and fulfillment are to be found. God's purposes for us is to regain our lost humanity and to become whole persons who will live forever in a new creation. It is not for this life only that God is preparing us, but for something far more glorious and splendid. This is all made possible not by our best efforts, but by the grace and mercy he has already lavished upon us and is ready to supply anew if we would but ask. Because of this, C.S. Lewis wrote, it may be possible for each to think too much of his own potential glory hereafter. It is hardly possible for him to think too often or too deeply about that of his neighbor. This load or weight or burden of my neighbor's glory should be laid on my back, a load so heavy that only humility can carry it, and the backs of the proud will be broken. It is a serious thing to live in a society of possible gods and goddesses. To remember that the dullest and most uninteresting person you talk to may one day be a creature which, if you saw it now, you would be strongly tempted to worship, or else a whore and a corruption, such as you now meet, if at all, only in your worst nightmare. All day long, we are in some degree helping each other to one or other of these destinations. It is in light of these overwhelming possibilities, it is with the awe and circumspection proper to them, that we should conduct all of our dealings with one another. All friendships, all loves, all play, all politics. There are no ordinary people. You have never talked to a mere mortal. Nations, cultures, arts, civilizations, these are mortal. And their life is to ours as the life of a gnat. But it is immortals with whom we joke, marry, snub, and exploit. Immortal whores or everlasting splendors. Humanity, made in the image of God to live forever and ever. You're either going to live apart from him in everlasting torment, or you're going to live with him in everlasting love and victory and glory. And God has a whole new plan, which Dr. Coburn will speak about next week, the new heaven and the new earth and the bridegroom. What's it going to be? Heaven or hell? Where are you going to go? Where are you spending eternity? Are you sure? Are you positive? All over this auditorium tonight, the last thing I want to say is, where are you going to spend eternity? Do you know? Because if you have not made Jesus Christ the Lord and the Savior of your life, now I have explained the gospel to you. God knew we needed a Savior. God knew we couldn't save ourselves. For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever would believe in him would not perish, but have everlasting life. Where are you tonight? Is he Lord of your life? Have you made him Savior and boss? Are you living for him? Are you living for yourself? Are you a little in, a little out? You're here tonight. God brought you here because he's not mad. He's not angry. He loves you and he has a plan for your life. But he cannot make you receive him. He's given you a free will. And he said, I'm knocking at the door of your heart, but you've got to open the door and let me in. He will not force his way in to a human life. That's the beauty of being human, made in the image of God. He's given us a free will to choose, just like in the millennium, life or death. If you've never said yes to Jesus Christ, if you've never made him the Lord and Savior of your life, and you're here tonight, and you know that it's time to get right with God, I'm going to count to three, and I'm just going to ask you to raise your hand. We're going to do it together. If you've played with God, and you've been in and out, up and down, but now you know it's time to get serious, and it's time to make him not just Savior, but Lord of your life. I want you to lift your hand and let's get right with God tonight. No matter how good you've been, no matter how much you've been raised up in the church, church doesn't get you to heaven. Jesus Christ is Savior and Lord, not the rock, not anything else. And all I'm doing is simply inviting you to come and meet the man that can change your life. His name is Jesus. All over this auditorium, if you've been running from him instead of to him, I'm talking to you. You look at your life and you think you're a mess and you don't trust yourself. Good on you, because you can't trust you, but you can trust him to change you like he changed me from the inside out. I'm going to count to three and we'll do it together. Are you ready? All over this auditorium. 1, 2, 3. If you need to get right with God, I want you to raise your hands right now. Just lift your hands. I see that hand. Help me, ushers, because I don't have my glasses on. I see one hand. I know there's more in here. I know there's at least five more people that need to get right with God tonight. Holy Spirit told me. He's talking to me. I see that hand. There's two. I see that hand. There's three. Who else needs to get right with God? We're a small group tonight. Just celebrated Halloween. But you know what? Your heart's pounding. You wish I'd shut up. But this grandma is not going to shut up. Because if he can save me to the uttermost, he can save you. But it's going to take you to open your heart and say, okay, I can't do it, God. I need a Savior. I know you're the Lord. Will you take me as I am? And he will. Anybody else? All right, this is what we're going to do. Will you stand with me? I'm not here hawking knives at the county fair. I'm here to introduce you to Jesus Christ and give you an opportunity to get right with God. If you raised your hand or you didn't and you should have, I just want you to get out of your seats, bring whatever, grab whatever you got to church with, purses, coats, whatever, friends. Come and join me and let's get right with God right here at this altar. If he can die for me on a cross, naked and bloody, as the Son of God, the creator of heaven and earth, I can walk an aisle and say, I need Jesus. So come quickly. If you need to get right with God, don't wait. Just come. If you're in the family rooms, we'll wait for you, but come quickly. Don't raise your hand and say yes and then expect. Listen, if you confess me before men, I'll confess you before my Father. You don't get saved by walking an aisle. You get saved by inviting Jesus into your life and letting him be Lord and Savior. Let's get right with God tonight. Let's get right tonight. It's time to get right with God. Today is the day of salvation. You don't have tomorrow. You have now. Well, there's two of you. Listen, the angels rejoice when there's one. Bless you. Look at me. Darling girl, precious man, you're not going to a funeral. You're going to a birthday party, and it's yours. He's not mad at you. He loves you. He's got a plan for your lives. This is Pastor Joel. You're going to go with him. We're going to pray with you privately. So if you'll just follow him, and we're going to pray with you, and we've got something to give you, and good call.
Hey, you just heard that altar call. You just wanted to give God all of your heart and all of your life. Now let me lead you simply in a prayer of inviting Jesus Christ into your heart as your Lord and Savior. In fact, why don't you just go ahead and listen to me and go ahead and close your eyes and just repeat these words after me. I'll go slow. You repeat them. Say these words. Say, Father God, I come to you in the name of Jesus. I believe that Jesus Christ is your only begotten Son and that you sent him for me. And then he died for me on that cross at Calvary. I believe that his blood washes away my sins, that I am now a new creature in Christ Jesus. And I thank you, Lord. I receive you now and forever as my Lord and as my Savior. I'm going to turn from sin, and I'm going to turn with all of my heart and all of my life to you, Jesus, as my Lord and as my Savior. Let it be known in heaven, as well as upon the earth, that I am born again. I'm a child of God, that I'm saved, and I'm headed for heaven and denying my presence in hell. Thank you, Jesus. I'm alive forevermore. Love you so much. God bless you guys. Everybody just say amen and receive Christ as your Lord and Savior. So talk to you later. God bless you.
Thank you for listening to the Rock Church and World Outreach Center. If this message spoke to you, please share it with us. We'd love to hear from you. You can find more information at www.rockchurch.com.